Good morning, and welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Church of Columbia Online, a congregation striving to embody courageous love, radical welcome, and deep connection. I'm Todd Iveson, the worship associate this morning, and I'm so glad to welcome you to our community. We are grateful to our online worship to be able to connect with many people from Missouri and beyond. Wherever you are connecting, we welcome you. A few comments about protocol for today's meeting. We are in Zoom and streaming live on Facebook. We are in Zoom webinar mode, so we can't hear or see you. Feel free to eat your breakfast in your PJs, and don't worry if your day is a bit noisy. You will be able to say hello and interact with the service through the chat feature on Zoom and the comments on Facebook. If you're with us on Zoom, make sure you select panelists and attendees so everyone can see your comment. This will be particularly useful if you wish to share a joy or sorrow when we reach that portion of the service. A few notes about accessibility. We are using Zoom's native auto captioning service, which means you'll see automatically generated subtitles at the bottom of your screen. If you prefer, you can hide or alter the subtitles by clicking the closed caption button on your screen. We know that auto captioning is never entirely accurate, but we hope it is close enough to be helpful. We will also be providing spoken descriptions of the videos and images we use, and we'd like to invite you to please contact us if you have any other accessibility or inclusion needs that we can strive to meet in our online worship. If this is your first time worshiping with us, we'd like to invite you to fill out a digital visitor's card in the link provided in the chat and let us know a little bit about you. If this is your first time worshiping with us, we'd like to invite you, I'm getting used to having different cameras this week, so if I have a few screw-ups like that, please forgive me. Our minister, the Reverend Molly Hausch Gordon, is away on sabbatical until August 2nd, and we are honored during that time to be served by the Reverend C.W. Dawson as sabbatical minister, who is preaching this morning. And I'd like to thank the folks who make our online worship possible. Thank you today to our online usher, Linda Valentine, our on-site tech coordinator, Larry Lyle. And as always, we are grateful to our amazing staff. April Rodagero is running slides. Aaron Dyke-Holly prepared the digital liturgy. Religious educator Jamila Batchelder and music director Jeremy Wagner and pianist Hans Bridger-Harith. Will you please take a deep breath, find a comfortable position for your body, and sink into this time of inspiration and this space of renewal with the help of our musician. Hans. Thank you. Our opening words this morning are by Timothy Haley. Amid all the noise in our lives, we take this moment to sit in silence, to give thanks for another day, to give thanks for all those in our lives who have brought us warmth and love, to give thanks for the gift of love. We know we are on a pilgrimage here, but a brief moment in time. Let us open ourselves here, now, to the process of becoming more whole, of living more fully, of giving and forgiving more freely, of understanding more completely the meaning of our lives here on this earth. Please join in singing our gathering hymn, Morning Has Come. You'll find the words on the screen and in the chat. This version was recorded by Michael Tacey. The video shows sunrises in nature over mountains, shining between trees, through the early morning mist and fields. Morning has come. We now light our chalice, the symbol of our faith in the community that holds us, and the bright flame of the human spirit that unites us. As we share an image of our church chalice on the screen, you may wish to light a candle at home or look in the chat for a digital chalice. Please join me in lifting your voices and homes across our city, country, and world to share our weekly words of affirmation shown on the slide and shared in the chat. Love is the spirit of this church, and service is its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. Our centering moment this morning is an excerpt from the book, Did I Say That Out Loud? by Reverend Meg Barnhouse, Senior Minister of the First Unitarian Universalist Church of Austin, Texas. It is entitled Brick by Brick. All summer, workers have been building a brick wall along the road by my neighborhood. Against the brutal heat, they stretch a tarp overhead to get a little shade. I've watched them take bricks in their dusty brown hands one by one, butter them thickly with mortar, line them up, and lay them down, row by row. One man, who looks to be in his 70s, is the leader. His skin is the color of bittersweet chocolate. His beard is gray. Slender and tall, he moves from one group of bricklayers to the next, reaching and bending, looking like a heron in a marsh. When he pauses, he stands very straight. I see him teach the others how to do the work. He stoops over to look at the line of bricks, hands on his thighs, inspecting the work. Sometimes, as I see him drive by, I see him put his hand on the back of the person he's teaching. Often, they are both smiling. He looks like he loves what he's doing. I wonder how he can love building walls day after day, handling bricks, teaching the art of laying bricks. Is it the teaching he loves? Seeing how his students learn, what their styles are, how their work shows their character? Does he love the wall itself? Does he know about when it'll be done? Does he look forward to seeing it finished? Or does he love the process, the feel of the bricks in his hands, the squish of the mortar, the challenge of making the symmetry of pillars and arches, the geometry of it? I think, from the look on his face, that he loves the process. I imagine that he never thinks about the end of the project, the completion of the wall. I think he will go on to the next wall as if it were just a continuation of this one, then the next one, and the next, and never be bored. I want to be like that, and I am, I guess. In my job as a minister, the bricks are stories. I hear stories of family and work, stories of loss and reconciliation, stories of rejection and disaster, illness and healing, birthing and dying. I tell stories every Sunday, and in between, teaching, challenging, confessing, inviting people to learn and laugh and think. Brick by brick, story by story, we build a church, seeing the patterns, the symmetry, the plain joy of setting one story on the other, sustained by the stirring and beautiful structures they make. We will never be finished, and it's okay. And now, as we share an image of lit candles and our joys and sorrow stones on the screen, I'd like to invite you to bring our loving attention and compassionate presence to our community as we share the joys, sorrows, and prayers of our community. Let us hold one another in heart across the distance, remembering our connections and feeling that we are held in love amid life sorrows and joys alike, now and always. I will begin by sharing the joys and sorrows submitted at our website, and then I will invite those who are gathered to share your joys and sorrows in the chat. We join our hearts with the Reverend C.W. Dawson and his wife Maria, who mourn the death of their godson, Junius Kelly, this week. He was 24 years old and was shot at the Vault nightclub here in Columbia. Stephen and Joan Mudrick report that Desi Long has arrived in Minneapolis, Minnesota with her daughter, Nora. Desi will be living in St. Paul, Minnesota. We are sorry she has moved, but we all wish her well. I'm not seeing any joys or concerns being expressed in our chat this morning. Oh, actually, just one popped up. Chuck Swaney, it's a sad day with the 100th anniversary of the Tulsa massacre. Our hearts go out to those whose lives were taken, homes, churches, schools, and businesses destroyed. May the city of Tulsa, the state of Oklahoma, and our country remember and no longer hide this important, uncomfortable part of our history. And may those who are descendants of the massacre, and those who are descendants of this massacre. Sarah Ellis has joy because she had family with dinner after not a long time. Very grateful to see her family and enjoy time together. Please join me in the spirit, one more joy in seeing Lynn Malley says, joy in seeing both of my kids last week, first time since pre-COVID. Chuck Swaney adds to his previous note, may the descendants have comfort and compensation. Amen. Please join me in the spirit of meditation and prayer, listening to these words by Reverend Laura Horton Ludwig. Spirit of life and love, we are here because we believe what we do matters. We are here because we believe how we live our life matters. That with every act of kindness or meanness, courage or fear, love or hate, we are weaving the fabric of the universe that holds us all. We are here because we need encouragement, because we need strength, because so often we get distracted. We get in a rush. We don't think. We choose the easy way, when the harder path is what our spirits truly long for. We are here because none of us is perfect, but together we inspire one another to try again, to take another step. We are here because we have felt the stirrings of love and grace in our hearts and hands, and we crave more of that for ourselves, and not only for ourselves, for everyone. We are here because how we live matters. Blessed be. I invite you to sing along with The Spirit of Life by Carolyn McDade. Nylea Butler Moore arranged the hymn for choir, and it is sung by the UU Virtual Singers of the Unitarian Church of Los Alamos. The slide includes the lyrics, which also appear in the chat, and a photo of rocks at the shore of the ocean, shrouded by mist with a pink and blue sky. Spirit of Life.
Come to me.
Our first reading is from Nicomachean Ethics by Aristotle, adapted for gender inclusivity. Good moral character is not something that we can achieve on our own. We need a culture that supports the conditions under which self-love and friendship flourish. We are what we frequently do. It is not always the same thing to be a good person and a good citizen. Character is that which reveals moral purpose, exposing the class of things a person chooses and avoids. The beauty of the soul shines out when a person bears with composure one heavy mischance after another, not because the person does not feel them, but because the person is one of high and heroic temper. For our interlude, we share with you the official music video from 1997 for the song Represent by Soul to Soul. The entire video is in black and white and shows a multitude of snippets of people in Britain being in community. Most of the people shown are black, but many scenes show a black person with a white person or people of differing races. At times throughout the video, words are briefly shown on the black screen, questioning our relationship to race, racism, and ourselves. Our next reading is a collection of quotes from the Buddha. Purity and impurity are terms that can define a person. You have the ability to be a pure person, and you have the ability to be an impure person. The decision is ultimately up to you. Nobody else can decide that for you. Only the occupant of the human mind can purify himself. Purity is something we are all striving for and hope to achieve. Pure soul means no regrets or anxiety toward the future or past. Pure souls believe in humanity and try to grow every day. Our daily thoughts become who we are. Make sure your thoughts describe the kind of person you want to be. Spending too much time thinking misguided thoughts will lead down a road of impure thoughts. And our final reading is Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23. Keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it spring the issues of life.
Good morning. When I was a younger preacher, the older preachers used to say, be careful what you say you're going to preach about, because the weak might haunt you with things to think about. Character. It was amazing that on last Sunday, my wife and I, after having a little breakfast, got the phone call that our godson had been shot and killed at a nightclub here in Columbia. The same day, that afternoon, another young black man was killed in front of a nightclub downtown Columbia. Both of them in their 20s. Both of them shot because somebody decided that they weren't worth living. Wiley Miller, a member of this congregation, Dr. Miller said at the soil collection, he said, you gotta remember that soil is a derivative of the word humus, to which the other derivative is humanity. And how is it that one piece of soil can look at another piece of soil and say, you don't deserve to live? Character. I was reminded, and then all of us today, that 100 years ago today, a lack of character destroyed Black Wall Street. You remember Black Wall Street, it was part of Tulsa. It was a place where African Americans pooled their money, worked together as a community, and built stores and had banks and were able to put together an economic situation in which they could strive to survive. And a lack of character wiped them out. Character. I watched this week how the legislature, how the Congress could have put together a bipartisan commission in order to find out what we already know, what really happened January 6th. But a lack of character said, no, we can't do that because it might make us look bad. How do we start to distinguish what character is? And how do we be a part of a process in this country to talk about character one more time? I'm borrowing this morning from both the Buddha and from Aristotle. In my earlier days, I used to read a lot of Plato, but I came to a problem with Plato is that Plato says, I'm a body and a soul. I'm a body and a soul. I'm two different substances. When I was 340 pounds, I used to eat a lot of salad. And the reason, Larry, Todd, I ate so much salad is because they said it would help me lose weight. You could tell I'm still having a hard time finding something that'll fit after all the weight I've lost. But my favorite dressing was to put together vinegar and oil. And I would shake it, and I would shake it. And yet, no matter how much I shook it, it never mixed. As a human person, am I two different substances walking around in the same body? I don't think so. Instead, I want to go with Aristotle. Aristotle says, listen, what we are is that we are blank slates that come into the world. The Nicomachean Ethics is really clear about this. We are blank slates that come into the world, and we have the opportunity to develop character, either good or bad. My conservative Christian friends get mad at me when I talk like this because they say we are born in sin and shaped in iniquity. My conservative Roman Catholic friends, Christian too, Roman Catholic friends said, I'm stained with original sin. I'm stained with original sin. I've got to get rid of that in order that I might produce the right kind of character. My Anabaptist friends say, you got to be baptized in order to wash away the stain of sin that's within the person. Aristotle says, wait a minute. What about the fact that maybe we've come as blank slates and that character is something that's built, that is created within us? And notice how Aristotle does it. Let me lift up two things that I find very important about this. The first one is, Aristotle says, we need a good moral teacher. We need someone who will teach us the virtues by which we need to practice. What are the good moral teachers among us? It used to be a simple question. It used to be, sure, it was the clergy. Sure, it was a judge. Sure, it was a police officer. Sure, it was the politician. Sure, it was someone who worked in the community. But all of us now have found out that just because you have a title doesn't mean you're a good moral teacher. You and I, all of us who are listening today, know a whole lot of people who are very smart, terrible moral teachers. From my past, as somebody when I was in graduate school, Paul Tillich says wonderful stuff about how God is the ground of being and how we have and live in a world of both ontic, everyday realities and ontological, bigger realities. Good stuff. In fact, Martin Luther King was reading Courage to Be by Paul Tillich under his bed while his house was being bombed. Paul Tillich said some good stuff, but he was a horrible moral teacher. Just because you have a degree, just because you have a title, doesn't make you a good moral teacher. What makes a good moral teacher? Someone who understands the virtues. Let me lift up a couple of them. How about this one? Friendliness. Friendliness, a virtue by definition, is the middle between two extremes. So friendliness is the middle between a haughty ego. Yeah, Lord help me with this. A haughty ego, and cantankerousness. You ever meet somebody that no matter what you say, where you meet them, that they always got a bad attitude? You say good morning, they say you another one. Cantankerousness, friendliness is the mean between two extremes. How about courage? Courage is a mean between foolhardiness. When I lived in Fulton, the Fultonians told me foolhardiness was going to a gunfight with a knife. Foolhardiness over and against cowardice. You know, cowardice. In all our churches, we've experienced cowardice. You know, that's those folks who just go whichever way the wind blows, never take a stand on anything. I know y'all as UUs never experienced that. But for those of us who come out of the Anabaptist tradition, you know what I'm talking about. Or how about, it doesn't have to be Christian, Western, or it can also be Eastern. How about ahimsa? The pledge that I will do no harm. Or how about the virtues of things like right mindfulness, right character, right thinking, right livelihood? All of those are virtues in which if we learn them, it helps us to move toward being of good character. A good moral teacher has to be able to teach us the virtues. But the second part is, you have to have a good moral process. Ladies and gentlemen, we can sit in our homes, in our cars, in our offices, and think, I'm a good person, I'm a good person, I'm a good person. But we never know if we are good people until we get out in traffic on Providence or on the highway, and somebody cuts us off. And then we find out, do we speak in tongues that are not holy and give hand signs? What is our character? It comes from this. Aristotle suggests first it starts with act. You got to do something. You have to start with an act. Like if someone's kind to you, you say, thank you. If someone hurts you, you say, I forgive you. If someone is close to you, you say, I love you. I met a man the other day, he's 55 years old. He said in all of his lifetime, his father never told him, I love you. Starts with an act. And then the act will become a habit. None of us this morning had to think about getting up, brushing our teeth. It's a habit. Now, most of us, when we see somebody walking through a door and we're ahead of them, we'll open the door and say, and let them go through first. I even watched some people in the store, and these are hard times after the pandemic. Ladies and gentlemen, a lot of us are out here struggling and yet paid forward for somebody who was in line that didn't have enough to pray for all their groceries. It's become habit. To be kind, to be virtuous. Starts with an act, which then becomes a habit, which then becomes part of your character. There are people we all know of good character. We hear rumor and we say, nah, not them. Because we've gotten to know that their character is such that that's not that they're perfect, but there's just some stuff they wouldn't do. I hope it said the same about us. That one time I was early in ministry and I got to letting people just stay in my house. Bad decision. And the person I didn't know was substance dependent. They were on crack cocaine. And I left the house. And when I got back, my TV was gone. My radio was gone. Y'all ain't hearing me. I wish I had somebody feel me this morning. That stuff was gone. I know the drug made them do it. But they weren't at the point where their character had turned to be good. It comes, says Aristotle, first as an act, then a habit, then it becomes part of our character, and then it becomes a rete. It's an excellence of character. You know what I mean. There are some people that are so excellent in character that that when they walk in the room feels their spirit. Act, habit, character, arete. Dawson, why is it so important for us to think about these today? Well, and then I'm gonna leave you alone. It's important because if we had a recommitment in this society to character, that we wouldn't have to put body cams on police officers because it'd be character. We wouldn't wake up and listen to the news and hear about a person 2 years ago who was stopped and dragged from his automobile and killed in the great state of Louisiana. We wouldn't have to tomorrow on the steps of the courthouse have a memorial for George Floyd, see, because if it was a commitment with character, no person of character would stand on the neck of another person for 9 minutes and 28 seconds. We've got to have a recommitment to character. And so that's why UU family, I keep sneaking these videos in. because you can't tell character until it's actuated. You gotta show me. The Nazarene says that you will judge a tree by the fruit that it bears. Character. Why recommitment? That's why these little strange videos like this one, and then I'm gonna leave you alone. Character demands of us to say to one another, I won't harm you with words from my mouth. I love you. I need you to survive. And listen, let me add one more with it. You pray for me, and I'll pray for you. Because I figured out with character, we are all part of God's body. That we are all in this together. And character says, but if we hold one another's hand, soon and very soon, we shall see the victory. And we shall celebrate together how we made it over. Character, let it be so. Amen.
Now is the time in our service when we join in the spiritual practice of generosity, guiding our hearts away from the fear and scarcity all around us, and remembering that it is by sharing and supporting one another that we feel most human. Our offertory music is I Believe by Sounds of Blackness. The slide shows a formal photograph of the ensemble, a group of 28 black musicians dressed in black, many of them holding instruments. I Believe.
I believe.
Our closing words are from Reverend Eric Walker Wickstrom. If you are who you were, and if the person next to you is who he or she was, if none of us have changed since the day we came in here, we have failed. The purpose of this community, of any church, temple, zendo, mosque, is to help people grow. We do this through encounters with the unknown in ourselves, in one another, in the other, whoever that might be for us, however hard that might be, because these encounters have many gifts to offer. So, may you go forth from here this morning, not who you were, but who you could be. So may we all. Please join in singing our benediction. The words are on your screen and in the chat. Please join us at the link in the chat or the meeting ID on the slide for coffee hour when we get a chance to see one another's face and catch up in small breakout rooms. Thank you for spending a part of your morning with us, and have a wonderful day.